Welcome. Good morning, Brother Lori. How are you? And Brother Phil. Karen's not well today, so she'll be... Karen, have you joined us yet? Not yet. Okay. So it is a little... That's all smoke outside, not rain clouds.
So it's a clear day.
Above the cloud, it's a clear day.
Above the smoke.
Yeah, above the smoke. I saw a satellite picture that showed the smoke going all, the plume going all across the United States, all the way up to Michigan. The smoke is just, it's massive. So
is it reaching beyond the valley or
no?
It's gone up into British Columbia. I think it's reached as far as the Okanagan. They're most of southern British Columbia, but BC has very few fires of its own this year. They said the reports are that the wet spring and summer that we had early summer was such that our forests are still fairly damp, and so we haven't had too many of our own fires.
Where is the main fire?
For us, it is Eastern Washington State and Oregon, where the smoke is coming up. And there's weather systems, high pressure weather, evidently in south of us that are pushing the smoke up towards our direction. So. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
We are still in Ephesians chapter 2. We are still looking at the middle wall of partition. And we're going to continue on now. We're going to look at a parable which addresses the understanding, the teaching, that it was at the cross that Jew and Gentile were now sort of made one. That there was a rejection of Christ by Israel at the cross, and so now that and the temple veil was rent from top to bottom, and so that now afforded all believers to come to Christ equally. So that's why then people say, well, I'm a Christian and I follow Jesus, and so I now have to do what Jesus says to do. So we're going to examine a couple of things today. We're going to look at the parable of the fig tree that Jesus gave in Luke chapter 13. And the parable of the fig tree, actually Jesus communicates exactly what the plan is going to be concerning Israel and their acceptance of him. We're talking about mercy. And then we'll look at the events surrounding the early church in Jerusalem, and in particular, the individual, a deacon by the name of Stephen, and why the stoning of Stephen was very significant. So what we're going to look at today is that at the cross would be the place that Israel stumbled. So they stumbled, and we talked last Sunday about the difference between a stumble and then a fall. So a stumble, I can recover myself. If I stumble, I don't have to fall flat on my face, I can recover myself. But once one begins to fall, a fall leads to grounding out, and that's what happened. So there was the stumble, they didn't recover from the stumble, so then Israel went to the fall. So then we're going to look at how these things will clarify for me exactly how long Israel had, even after the cross, to yet accept Jesus as their Messiah. And that things had not gone to Gentiles. We were still on this side of the wall. We were still parted away from Israel, and we're without hope. So that's the plan. And so we'll go ahead and we'll sing.
Number 28. Songbooks, let's stand. And the title is My Hope Is in the Lord. I can't see the title.
All right. Okay, turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew. We're going to take a look at Matthew. Matthew, and we're going to verse 50. So, I'm sorry, Matthew 27, and starting with verse 50. We're just going to look at a couple of verses. So, the middle wall of partition went into existence when? It went into existence with Abram. Okay, with Abram. Before he even became Abraham, because God made promises to him which were unique to him and not to any other person, let alone any other nation. So they continued to develop, so the middle wall of partition went into existence with Abram. They became even more a fact of reality with Moses when God gave Israel the law, and that was the law was just given to Moses and Israel, and the law was given to them for what purpose? To set them apart. Right. Yes. So that they would be a light. So they, because there was nothing else pointing to God in the world. So there was just, the world was full of darkness. God took Abram. Yes?
I was going to say the law was also given to them to show them that they couldn't keep it. It was wrong.
Well, yeah, so the law wasn't given to them for the purpose to show that they couldn't keep it. Mm-hmm. That is an outcome later, but at the time it was given to them, and so we say, well, where do you get this from? So this is Deuteronomy chapter 4. And Deuteronomy chapter 4 tells me exactly why the law was given to them. It was to be for their testimony, their witness amongst the nations, that the nations would see a people living in harmony with God. That's why the law was given. And Israel was set apart so that they wouldn't become polluted by the nations of the world and their wicked ways of living. So they had to be separated. They were given a way to live so they would be a light and others would see this and be attracted to Israel and to God, really, not to Israel so much, but to God. So I know that from what Scripture says, especially in Deuteronomy chapter 4, very clear. So then it's continuing at the time of Moses. The Davidic covenant was a promise that was made to the nation, and specifically to David, that there would be one coming from him that would sit on his thrones, and that Israel would never want of a king. They would always have a king. So that further separated Israel. So this separation, Abram, Moses, David, even with John the Baptist. And John the Baptist, I was listening to a video yesterday of a fellow who was explaining why he left the church. He left the church because the church was not preaching the Bible, and because the Bible, John the Baptist said, repent and be baptized. Repent of your sins and be baptized. So unless you have the ceremony, the rite of baptism to wash away your sins, you're not saved. So that's the fundamental mistake there, is not paying attention who's speaking and to whom they are speaking. And the matter is, and not seeing that there's a separation between Jew and Gentile. There aren't Gentiles here flocking after Jesus and calling him Messiah. The Messiah wasn't promised to Gentiles. So this continued, and then at the cross, so Jesus, well, actually, before we get to the cross, Jesus even explained, not only to his followers, but specifically to his disciples, why he was sent. So why was Jesus sent? To whom was Jesus sent? He was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So he was sent to Israel. What about John 3:16? For God so loved the world. Yes, God does love the world, but the plan of salvation wasn't for Jesus to go knocking on Gentile doors, let alone the disciples to go around knocking on Gentile doors and handing out tracts, quoting the kingdom, the gospel of the kingdom. Not at all. So Jesus loved, for God so loved the world, Israel was the light, so salvation. Israel was to be the salvation of the world. They were to, the world, I as a Gentile, were to find my way back to God through Israel's example. That's how God so loved the world. So then, at Matthew 15, 24, we see that Jesus tells his disciples that he's not sent but to the lost sheep of Israel. And then he's rejected at the cross. All right, so this is Matthew 27. Matthew 27, and we'll just look at a couple of verses. And at Matthew 27, verse 50. So Jesus has been on the cross now for hours, and he says in verse 50, Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake, and the rocks were rent, which is to say split. The graves were open, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose and came out of their graves, etc. So I have a note in my Bible. This is my C.I. Schofield Bible. And in my C.I. Schofield Bible, I have a note. And in this note, this is what I was taught. And this is what I understood to be true about what happened at the cross. So the note reads, this is C.I. Schofield's note. The rending of that veil, rending is tearing. The rending of that veil, which was a type of the human body of Christ, signifies that a, quote, new and living way, quote, was open for all believers into the very presence of God, with no other sacrifice or priesthood save Christ. All right, so the point being, what Schofield is saying, is now that the tearing of the veil from top to bottom shows that the path was now open for everybody to come to Christ. All right, and they didn't need to have any other sacrifice now. The only sacrifice that was required was just what Christ had done. So this is what I was taught, and this is what I understood to be true, but today I have more scripture, and by more scripture I understand that it's not correct to understand that.
So Schofield was saying that that applies to Gentiles as well, is that what
Yes.
You're
so he says
not just Israel.
Yes, signified that a new and living way was open for all believers. So that all believers means you could be a believer, I could be a believer, any of us could be now believers. The way was now open for us to become Christians, okay? Because before he had said, I'm only sent to Israel. And so, you know, Schofield read that verse. He goes, oh, he was only sent to Israel. And so now with the cross and the rejection, and this is actually, Schofield notes in his Bible, he says the dispensation of the law ends.
I like when they know beside that.
So the dispensation, now hear this, the dispensation of the law ends at the death of Christ on the cross, according to Schofield. This is what I was taught. This is what I understood to be true. And now I see this is not correct. Now, the rending of the veil, and actually it was Romolini that asked, well, didn't the tearing of the veil, didn't that open the way for everybody? Not at all. And in fact, this matter of a new and living way, those words are never quoted by Paul. They're quoted by the writer to the Hebrews. And so it was the Hebrews that would read about the new and living way, not a Gentile. So the fact that that Scofield is pointing to what Hebrews writes is not then confirmation for me, a Gentile, that now the way was open for all believers. So you say, okay, well then, so what's the deal? So this is where we're going. The way did not become open until Paul. The way did not become open for Gentiles until Paul. How do I know that? I know that by looking at the following. So we're going to start first with a parable. We're going to go to Luke chapter 13. Matthew, Mark, Luke.
We're in Matthew.
So we just read the verses.
Oh yeah, I was paying attention.
You were thinking and asking questions.
Yeah.
All right. Matthew 13. I'm sorry. Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13.
Now, must be the small pages affecting
my. I know. Luke chapter 13, and we're going to look at a parable here from verse 6 to verse 9. Now, what this parable tells me is that Israel was going to have more time than just the time that led to the cross. That Israel was going to have another year of mercy extended to them. Mercy, not grace, but mercy, because they had rejected. And so God was not, so what did Christ say on the cross? Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Would Israel have been forgiven? Yes, of course. Christ prays to the Father for forgiveness. Israel gets forgiveness. So now we're going to see that there is an additional year, even though Christ himself has been rejected. He's still, and this is close to the end of his ministry, where this parable is found, and this is before he's put to the cross, but he's already telling them that there's going to be an extension. So here we are, Luke 13, verse 6. This is Jesus speaking. Jesus spake also this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought fruit thereon, and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, behold, these 3 years I come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? And he, answering, said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also. Note the words. Let it alone this year also, till I shall dig it about and dung it, and if it bear fruit, well, and if not, then after that thou shalt cut it down. So what I understand from this parable is that Christ is saying that after his 3 years of ministry on the earth, and even though they rejected him on the cross, they were going to get another year of opportunity, another year of mercy, to yet accept Christ as their Messiah. So it wasn't done yet. So the middle wall is still very much in place.
So the fig tree is referring to Israel.
Yeah, so let's look at the parable now. So he says, a certain man had a fig tree. Now, the fig tree points to what? Israel. So does a fig tree ever point to a Gentile? No. Although Matthew Henry seems to, the commentary, Matthew Henry, so I checked out Matthew Henry, and Matthew Henry says, we're all fig trees. We're all little fig trees, and we have to bear fruit as believers. We have to bear fruit, and if we don't bear fruit as believers, then we're going to be cut down. Okay, so this parallels I am the vine, ye are the branches, and every branch in me that beareth fruit, you know, is purged, and every branch that beareth not fruit is cut off and is burned in the fire. And so, you know, so somebody who sees it that way and doesn't understand the separation between Gentiles and Israel, you know, it seems to make sense to them that these branches off the vine are being burned, and now these fig trees, you know, you and I as little fig trees. Well, we only have a year to bear fruit because that's what the parable says. But then Matthew Henry doesn't want to take it literally. So he just sort of steps over everything and just says, it's up to us to bear fruit. And if we don't bear fruit, if our Christian lives don't bear fruit, then we're going to be cut down. Well, really, that's just not paying any attention at all to who's speaking and to whom he's speaking. So Jesus is speaking. He's there. He's not speaking to Gentiles. He's speaking to Jews. And this is a Jewish audience, and he's speaking to his disciples, and he's talking about the fig tree being Israel, and he's got lots of leaves on the tree, but there's no fruit. And so the thought is here, and I'll just share with you my understanding, that the man who has a vineyard is God the Father. And the dresser is Jesus.
Oh, I thought certain man was Christ, and the dresser was God, is God the Father.
Oh, the dresser was God the Father. Well, we won't make issues of this, but but this is God. This is God speaking to God, and it is said here that these 3 years I'm looking for fruit. So that's the 3 years of Christ's ministry on the earth. There's no fruit, and so God is fatigued of, he's weary of waiting, and he says, cut it down. It's done. I'm over with it. And so God says to God, give it another year, and he's going to fertilize it. And then if it bears fruit, then. So that's the first.
So, Matt,
yes.
This is a good example of how God negotiates with himself, how Jesus,
yes,
and God, like they have a relationship. It's not, you know, it's not one commandment. There's that whole relationship and fellowship that you see.
Yes.
Right? Because I think, you know, when you think of Jesus volunteering to come and die, it wasn't like, right?
There were conversations.
Yeah.
So this is hard for me to understand, God speaking to God, but God does speak to God. And there are the three persons of the Godhead. They can have quite a conversation. And this is something that is unique to God, that he can have a conversation. It's not like when I talk to myself, then you can say, well, Van's beginning to lose it. But when God speaks to himself, he's demonstrating his wisdom.
We see that,
yes,
start in Genesis 2.
Yes.
Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, and God said, let us make man in our image.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
Is that an example, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, so it's consistent all through Scripture. All right, so we know from this parable then that there's this 1 year extension. So that would mean then from the cross, after the first 3 years were here leading up to the cross, and then after the cross there would be an additional year. All right, so where does that additional year happen? So turn with me now to Acts chapter 6.
I had it backwards, but today.
Pardon me?
You're right, I have it backwards.
Oh, I don't have to be right. we're going to go to Acts chapter 6. Now, this is what we're looking at, are events at the church in Jerusalem. This is the early church in Jerusalem, those that believed that Jesus was the Messiah. And they were organized, and they had deacons. Besides the 12 apostles, or the 11 apostles at this, no, 12, because Matthias had been chosen. So they were choosing deacons who would serve the people, because they were living in, they were held out all things in common, and they were actually living and eating together, sharing all that they had. And so Acts chapter 6, put in at verse 5. And I just want to point out now an individual, verse 5, Acts chapter 6. And the saying pleased the whole multitude, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Ghost. That's all I need to read of that verse. So deacon, one of the deacons was Stephen. And Stephen is a man characterized as being full of faith and full of the Holy Ghost. Okay, important. Now I'm going to drop down to verse 8. So Acts chapter 6, verse 8, and I'm going to read from verse 8 to chapter 7, verse 2. Now what we're going to see here is this fertilizing of the fig tree. And this fertilizing of the fig tree, the last effort at fertilizing the fig tree is going to be done by Stephen. It had been done by Peter, now it's going to be done by Stephen. Acts chapter 6, verse 8. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. So notice, he's doing wonders and miracles. And why? Because Israel requires a sign to believe. Then there arose certain of the synagogue, which is called the synagogue of the Libertines and Cyrenians and Alexandrians. The Alexandrians, by the way, were the most liberal of the liberals. And of them of Cilicia and of Asia, disputing with Stephen.
Ben?
Yes.
Saul was from Cilicia.
Aha.
Saul of Tarsus.
Saul of Tarsus was from Cilicia.
So he was probably one of those too.
Yes. And verse 10, and they were not able to resist the wisdom and the spirit by which he, Stephen, spake. So, I mean, what I'm seeing here is that what Stephen is saying is so sound in terms of scriptural sense, they can't out-argue him, right? So he is putting down every one of their counter-arguments, he's putting them down. So they're not able to resist his wisdom. Verse 11, Acts 6, verse 11. Then they suborned men which said, we have heard him, that would be Stephen, speak blasphemous words against Moses and against God. And they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught him and brought him to the council. So they're not able to out-argue him. So what do? They get people, they get some people that are willing to lie, and they put together a false charge. And this false charge is that he is speaking blasphemous words. Now, what are blasphemous words? The word blasphemy is different from the word heresy. The word blasphemy, blasphemous words, would be irreverent words. Okay, that's the charge, irreverence before God. So blasphemy, when I read the word blasphemy, I don't understand that it's not saying heresy. It's saying irreverence. And they were charging him with irreverence.
Isn't that what they charged Jesus too?
They charged Jesus with blasphemy because he made himself to be a son of God.
So what is the difference?
Heresy. So blasphemy is irreverence before God, and heresy is wrong teaching. Wrong doctrine.
So when you're blaspheming before God.
When one blasphemies before God, one is being irreverent before God. We say, well, what's irreverence before God? Saying things that are not true or taking God's name in vain. Disrespectful of God, his position, his personhood. Those are all things of irreverence. So, how would I be irreverent to a policeman? Irreverence to a policeman would be to call him a pig, right? That's irreverence. But so, and we're taught then as law-abiding citizens to be reverent when we're faced with authority.
So,
Yes.
So blasphemy has to do with behavior and
heresy.
Or as a person.
So, yeah, heresy has to do with teaching, doctrine and teaching, same word.
Okay.
All right? So, a heretical teaching would be to say that Jesus is not the Son of God. Mm-hmm. Okay, that would be heresy.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Others.
They were saying blasphemy. He was saying against Moses.
Yes.
So, it wasn't that he was saying wrong doctrine, that what Moses said. He was just being not reverent to Moses's teaching, or is that what they're claiming?
They were claiming. So this was, and notice what they said. The charge in verse 11 is, we have heard him speak.
Yeah.
Right. So here's hearsay. We heard him say one time.
Yeah.
Against Moses.
Now, what does Moses represents? The law. Right. So to say blasphemous words against Moses is to show disrespect for the law, which is the way they live, and that could cause anarchy.
So he was trying to say the law is no longer in effect.
No. The point is, this is a blasphemous charge. Stephen was not guilty of saying anything that was blasphemous against Moses.
No, he could have been saying things that might have been heretical or different teaching than the conservatives, but they put up with a lot of strange teaching, right? Because everybody was
perhaps
a rabbi. They laughed.
Okay, but yeah, okay, and actually, Phil raises a very good point, because there's this mixed group of libertines, so. Cyrenians, Alexandrians, all these groups, they all see things differently.
They were
separated in how they understood things. So they weren't just like one homogenous group, and they're together, and Stephen's, there's like, they all have their own understandings.
And they often have debates amongst themselves.
They argued a lot, okay? And now Stephen is coming. Now, remember that the arguments that Stephen is giving them are full of wisdom. So Stephen's arguments are with wisdom, and they are of, now what is Stephen full of? He's full of the Holy Ghost. He's full of the Holy Ghost. He is speaking wisdom by virtue of the Holy Ghost. Yes.
Matthew 10:20, it backs up what you just said.
Yeah.
Jesus is saying, they're going to deliver you up and all this. Take no thought for what you speak. And verse 20 says, this is Matthew 10:20.
Yes.
It says, for it is not ye that speak, but the Spirit of your Father which speaketh in you.
Yes. So Phil just shared with us Matthew 10:20, which says, which. Now, this is unique to Israel. Israel was told, don't worry about it, take no thought for what you're going to say, because the Spirit is going to give you the words what to say. So here, Stephen is being, because he's full of the Holy Ghost, his words are being driven by the Holy Ghost. That's very important for me to pay attention to and recognize. This isn't just, a story here of something that happened. This is significant in that you have a man, Stephen, who is full of the Holy Ghost. He's speaking wisdom that cannot be resisted by these Jews. And so out of frustration, what do they do? Because they cannot out-argue him, right? That's the point. Can't out-argue him. So what do? They get some liars who are willing, they probably paid them some money. There's nothing has changed in the world. This continues to this day. If you can't get them by reason, then get them by falsehood.
I think it also depends too on what exactly Stephen did say to them that caused them to be frustrated and angry.
Yes,
because he was giving them a conflicting truth that against what they had always believed,
right,
spiritually.
Yes,
and they couldn't resist that, as it said, they couldn't argue against it. And like most of us, when somebody tells us something that's true, we get angry, right?
Yes.
And they just made up a bunch of, to them,
right,
it was a blasphemy.
Yes.
From
their perspective, was because that's not what they believed.
Right.
Stephen, as we'll see, Stephen is arguing that Jesus is the Christ.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He is the promised one. He is the Christ. And there were so many things that Stephen could draw from. I'll get to you in just a moment, sister, with you. So many things that he could draw from to prove that Jesus is the Christ, not the least of which is lineage. Jesus was born of Mary, who was of the line of Nathan, who was of King David. And then Jesus was adopted by Joseph, who was of the line of through Solomon to King David. And Joseph couldn't sit on the throne of David.
Joseph's seed, nor Joseph.
Could sit on the throne because there was a curse on the royal bloodline. So the royal bloodline came through Joseph. If he had physically fathered Jesus, Jesus would not be able to sit on the throne because there was a curse on the royal bloodline. This is what happened with King Jeconiah. King Jeconiah displeased God. God changed his name from Jeconiah to Coniah. To Coniah, the J-E refers to Jehovah. So instead of calling him Jehovah Coniah, it was now just Coniah, and said to Jeconiah, to Coniah, no man descending from you is going to sit on the throne of David.
So it was a problem for the Jews.
A problem. So you go, well, how can we have another king? God has cursed the kingly line. So the solution was eloquent, and Stephen could have argued this, and they would have seen, well, this makes perfect sense. So Jesus is born of Mary, and then what does Mary do but presents Jesus to Joseph, who then adopts Jesus as his son, and thereby now has the rights of a son of Joseph. And Joseph being a descendant of King David, but the curse now is broken because there's no longer a bloodline going from David to Jeconiah, Coniah to Joseph. And so now Jesus is uniquely qualified to take the throne.
Do you think the Pharisees, lost their records of all that, that they could see?
Yes.
That, because, they had to go census and all that. They had to go where they were from.
Right. It was all recorded.
Yeah.
But you know what they did? They kept persisting with the lie that he was born of fornication.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right? So if you can't get them with truth, then you get them with a lie.
Yeah.
So the charge was that Jesus was born of fornication.
Because they weren't married.
Right. So they refused that God could actually solve the problem. But the problem of the curse was solved. I think, Lucia, did you have a comment you might have?
Same with what you're saying, Brother Van, it is what they're vexing their souls because of the Messiah, because of Jesus Christ. And we can see in chapter 7 how Stephen really had so many verses all talking about Moses.
Yes.
And he just started from the beginning and to the...
That's the fertilizing. Yeah. So all that, and this message that Stephen is going to give these before the council. Now, and that's significant. Becoming before the council, that's coming before Israel now.
Yes.
So, okay. Brother Esme.
It's amazing how they couldn't argue against Stephen's sound
wisdom that
yeah.
you don't know lives there.
Yeah.
So they really just refuse just as they want to refuse?
They just refused because they weren't going to accept it. No. It was just, they just put their foot down, stomped their foot down, said, no, we don't want this.
Don't confuse me with the facts.
Don't confuse me with the facts.
Exactly.
I don't care if you're right, you're still wrong.
Did they know that that was death for them, though?
They were of their father, the devil.
Well, they had so many oral traditions, too, that they had added, right, during those 400 years of silence.
Yeah.
The Lord came to abolish all of those, right?
Yeah.
So
they are choosing the way they want to go. All right. Now we are in this extension of mercy now. So the cross has already happened, and we are now continuing beyond into the church in Jerusalem. And the members of the church in Jerusalem were all Jews and proselytes. There were no Gentiles in the church in Jerusalem. Jews and proselytes. And
what is a proselyte?
And a proselyte is one who becomes a Jew. So a Gentile who becomes a Jew, who then gives up his Gentile pagan ways and becomes circumcised and actually then follows the law. Okay, so yes, Lori.
I don't know what was the population of Israel back then? Because I just think, how many proselytes were there really?
Probably very few. Very few proselytes. And you think, to become a proselyte, and where do I get this from? It's Acts chapter 2, verse 10. And the ones that were in the church, they were from Phrygia, Pamphylia, in Egypt, and parts of Libya, and Cyrene, and strangers of Rome, Jews and proselytes. That's who made up the church in Jerusalem. No Gentiles. Really important that I take note. There are no Gentiles in the church in Jerusalem.
Do you think they still would have been considered outsiders, though?
Yes.
So
a proselyte.
Kind of, you know.
Yeah, a proselyte was a little lower. Yeah. Mm-hmm. They're a little lower.
It's very clear in verse 5 there, they're dwelling in Jerusalem, Jews.
Yes.
Devout men out of every nation under heaven.
Right, yeah. They're all Jews and proselytes, no Gentiles. So we are still, I'm still on this side of the wall. I have no hope.
Those Jews and the proselytes that we're talking about in chapter 2, they weren't believers of the church in Jerusalem. They were hearing the message of Peter.
Yes.
They were
hearing the message, but they are arguing every step along the way, and the arguments that are coming from Peter and now from Stephen are just such that they, you know, any sane person would say, I see your point. I didn't understand. No, they just absolutely are rejecting it. So there's no. Ever have a conversation with somebody where you disagree, but there's no give and take? When I say give and take, you make a point, they take that point, they hear you, they think about your point, and then they ask maybe another question on that, and they build it. That's when I know you know that you're having a constructive dialogue. When somebody hears your point, and they go, and they think about it, and then they ask you another point, and you go, you think about it. That's called give and take. And I know, for instance, when somebody comes and knocks on your door, and they're from one of these other churches, there's no give and take with them. They're there to tell me something. They're not interested in what I have to say. So there's no give and take. And that's what's happening here. There's no give and take. It is just, you're wrong, and we hate you. We hate you because your arguments are better than ours, but you're wrong. All right, so let's continue on. Acts chapter 6. So the charge of, verse 11, we saw that these suborned men, the word suborned means they had picked these fellows up, hired them, paid them something, and said, this is what we need you to say. So in verse 12, and they stirred up the people and the elders and the scribes and came upon him and caught Stephen, and brought him to the council. So that's a very significant word, council. This is no longer just a conversation in the crowd. This is now a legal hearing. All right? When you see council, that means this has now become official business. Verse 13, and set up false witnesses. Where have we heard that before? Has anything changed in our world? Nothing has changed in the world. False witnesses, which said, this man, that would be Stephen, this man Stephen ceaseth not to speak blasphemous words against this holy place and the law. I mean, that's like the essence of Israel, right? For, verse 14, for we have heard him say that this Jesus of Nazareth shall destroy this place and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us.
Customs.
Customs. You know, this matter of customs, their way of life, turn to Acts 21. Just a little sidestep here. I want you to see something in Acts 21. This matter of customs. You think that, you know, for me to think that the church in Jerusalem was this splendid spiritual organization that loved God and loved Jesus, this is what happened to them over time.
Talking about the church
in Jerusalem. Acts 21, and I'm going to put in at verse 18. This is Paul coming back from his third missionary journey. He comes to Jerusalem, and he comes, and in verse 18, and the day following, Paul went in with us unto James. James is now the head of the church in Jerusalem, and all the elders were present. And when he had saluted, he, Paul, had saluted them, he, Paul, declared particularly what things God had wrought among the Gentiles by his ministry. Notice, it wasn't the ministry of the church in Jerusalem, it was Paul's ministry certain results were happening among the Gentiles. Verse 20, Acts 21, verse 20, and when they heard it, they glorified the Lord and said unto him, now watch this, this is an abrupt change of direction in conversation. So they said, oh, that's good news, Paul, about the Gentiles. And now they say unto him, unto Paul, thou seest, brother Paul, how many thousands of Jews there are which believe, and they are all, what? Zealous of the law. So it's not zealous of grace. They're zealous of the law. This is the church in Jerusalem. Now, this is like 30 years after the church had started. And are they zealous of grace? No. They're zealous of the law. Now, look, here's the charge against Paul. Being made by James.
May I ask?
Yes.
Where they say thousands of Jews there are which believe, what are they believing?
Well, that's a good question. Yeah. Okay, so there are thousands, and actually the word that's translated thousands is actually the word myriads, which means almost an innumerable number. So it started off with hundreds and thousands, and now it's like many thousands of Jews that they believe and they are zealous of the law. That means they are law keepers. Now, verse 21. Yes.
I believe, just to answer the question probably, yes, that Jesus is the Messiah and he rose from the dead.
Yes.
Well,
maybe
that he rose from the dead. They would believe that Jesus is the Messiah. They wouldn't all necessarily believe that he rose from the dead. In fact, Paul had to argue that Jesus had risen from the dead virtually every time he met with Jews.
Yeah.
Every time. They thought, well, you know, he could have been the Messiah, but he's dead.
Yeah.
I've had Jews say that to me. I've had Jews who, when I like share the good news of Christ, they go, well, you know, he could have been the Messiah, but, you know, he's dead. He's dead.
Yeah,
so,
we yeah. heard about the false brethren. Mm-hmm.
Yes. False brethren had sinned. So they're reverting back to the law. Yeah. So now there's now the charge against Paul, and they are informed of thee that thou teachest all the Jews which are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, charge number one, saying that they ought not to circumcise their children, charge number two, neither to walk after the customs, charge number three. Three strikes, you're out, Paul. So this leads to a lot of problems. But note the things that are happening in the church in Jerusalem after all these years. They're still zealous of the law, still circumcising, and they're still following the ways of their custom. So back to Acts chapter 7. This is the early church in Acts chapter 7.
In Acts chapter 6.
I'm sorry, Acts chapter 6.
Verse
14. So the charge is, and shall change the customs which Moses delivered us. So you see the connection? Here it is at the beginning, and here it is 30 years later. They're still customs oriented. All right, so that's the charge. Now verse 15. So now the council has heard the indictment. And verse 15, and all that sat in the council, looking steadfastly on him, saw his face, that would be Stephen's face, saw his face as if it had been the face of an angel. So you say, well, what's the face of an angel? So what's the face of an angel? You look it up. If you look it up, it's a face of goodness and beauty, a baby face.
That's the worldly view.
So that's you'll find that in the dictionary. The face of a baby is goodness and beauty, yeah. Puckered lips, you know, the Cupid kind of look. So you want to know what the face of an angel looks like? The face of an angel is a face of authority. And so I know we're here talking about this, but we need to look at this because what I'd like you to see, what I see here, is that when this council was looking at Stephen, they weren't looking at a man that was sort of withering and sort of shaking and was cowering in front of the council, which the council would like to do. So the council would like to say, we're the council and we've got a charge against you. And they would like the man then to wither in front of him. But instead, they're looking at a face that is the face of an angel. Turn with me to Judges chapter 13. Joshua, Judges. After Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges. And this is regarding the birth of Samson. And we're going to... And this is the chapter 13 of Judges, chapter 13. And I'll take a brief look at chapter 13, verse 2. We're looking at the events leading to Samson's birth. It'll become apparent to you why this is important. And there was a certain man of Zorah of the family of Deantes. Danites.
From Danites.
Whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and barrenite. So Manoah's wife, the father of Samson, his wife is not named. Okay, now, verse 3. And the angel of the Lord, that's Jehovah God, the angel of Jehovah God appeared unto the woman and said unto her, Behold, now thou art barren and bearest not, but thou shalt conceive and bear a son. Now I want to drop to verse 6. In verse 6 we read, Then the woman came and told her husband, saying, A man of God came unto me, and his countenance was like the countenance of an angel of God. Note the words, very terrible. Very, so you say, well, he must have been ugly. It was like a terrible face. That's not what the word conveys. The word terrible that we find here in Judges 6:13 is the word that conveys fear. It was a fearful face. It was a face that demanded respect. It was a face that demanded awe. It was a face that demanded reverence. So a terrible face, when we see a terrible face, and actually that's the term that's used to describe an angel's face, is a face that actually demands. When Mary saw Gabriel, she was afraid. Because these angels, they stand in the presence of God. Imagine if somebody comes to meet with me, and they say, well, I stand in the, well, if I say he stands in the presence of Justin Trudeau, I guess I've got to go.
Yes, no.
Now, I'll use something more simple. When I get pulled over for speeding, and the officer looks in the window of my car, that face is, I would say, a terrible face. Right? Because what does it demand?
Respect. You
know, I don't say, what's the matter, pig? You know, it that face, because that face represents the law. And so there is, from me then, there's respect, there is reverence for the individual that's now looking at me. And so this is the face that the council, back to Acts chapter 7, the council is seeing, they're seeing a face that demands respect. All right, and they're the council.
Do you think it shines as well?
It may have shined, but it doesn't say. But whatever it was, Stephen is full of the Holy Ghost, and the Holy Ghost is manifest in him in his words, and now before the council, it is observable that his face was like an angel. Now, an angel is described as a man, the presence of a man. So he doesn't have to look like somebody with wings. He looks, in fact.
Well, Ecclesiastes 8:1, can I just read it?
Sure, go ahead.
Who is as the wise man, and who knoweth the interpretation of a thing? A man's wisdom maketh his face to shine.
Yes.
The boldness of his face shall be changed.
Yes. So I don't know that his face was shining. It doesn't say that, but it does say that he had the face of an angel. And we know that Manoah's wife, when she saw that face, the expression of the face was sufficient that she knew this was a face that she had to respect.
So this is the clash of two authorities.
Yes.
Two ultimate authorities. Those that hold the book of Moses and the customs.
Right.
And what the Holy Ghost is doing at this moment.
Okay, so Brother Phil really put his finger on it. This is the clash between those who would hold to the customs as they would understand from Moses, and they're not clashing with Stephen, all right? They're clashing with the Holy Ghost. It's very important for me to recognize they are clashing with God himself in the person of the Holy Ghost. So, now, chapter 7, verse 1. Then said the high priest, Are these things so? And the question alludes to the charges against Stephen, the blasphemous charges. And then in verse 2, Stephen opens his mouth and he says, And he said, Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken. The God of glory appeared unto our fathers Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Charan. Now, so now what he's going to do is he's going to go through the history of Israel up over the years. And I'm going to now take you through all the way through this, and I would encourage you to spend time to see all that Stephen said to the council. But now let's drop down to chapter 7, verse 49. Actually, verse 47. Verse 47, chapter 7 of Acts, verse 47. So this is Stephen still speaking. Verse 47, but Solomon built him an house. Howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet, heaven is my throne, and earth is my footstool. What house will ye build me, saith the Lord? Or what is the place of my rest? So Stephen is addressing this house because he's been charged with saying blasphemous words against the temple. And then verse 50, hath not my hand made all these things? Now note verse 51. Ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. That's a very steep charge. He's called them stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, which means they're filthy and they're stubborn. Ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. What were they resisting? This is Stephen speaking through the Holy Ghost to the council. He says, you're resisting the Holy Ghost. What is it to resist the Holy Ghost?
Blasphemy.
Absolute blasphemy. They had charged Stephen with blasphemy. What are they doing? They're resisting the Holy Ghost.
So if they believed, they would receive the Holy Ghost then.
If they had believed what Stephen was saying, because his arguments could not be resisted. Yes, Brother Philip.
You notice this is a very long speech.
It is. Yes. Yes.
And they allowed him.
And they allowed it. That's what I mean. Yes. He had authority, and they couldn't resist.
They couldn't resist.
You know, They couldn't interrupt, which they should have. They would have wanted to win this.
There was no give and take here.
They were ready their clothes and
they couldn't.
Well, it's coming, yeah.
It's their history.
Yeah. So they're listening to the story, and he's got them, the Holy Ghost has got, so he says, Stephen says, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. As your fathers did, so do ye. Verse 52, Acts 7, verse 52. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one? Here is the argument. Jesus is the Christ, the coming of the just one. And that the prophets had said, he's coming. This is the fertilizing. This is the dunging about of the fig tree. He's giving them things they know this is true. And then in verse 52, continuing, of whom ye have been now the betrayers, and note the word murderers. They murder Jesus Christ. They murdered him. In verse 53, who have received the law by the disposition of angels and have not kept it. Angels, this has all been delivered to you. You haven't kept it. You murdered the just one. So now the response, verse 54. When they heard these things, they were cut to the heart, and they gnashed on him with their teeth. So cut to the heart meaning, this really penetrated. All right. So you cut to the heart. I mean, it really got to them. They knew they were hearing truth, but they were not about to budge an inch. So what was their response? They gnashed on him with their teeth, which is to go, like, you're right and we hate you. All right? So this is like full of hate now. So they gnashed on him with their teeth, verse 55, but he, Stephen, being full of the Holy Ghost. Notice again, I mean, this passage has been reminding us over and over again, the Holy Ghost is here. The Holy Ghost is driving the bus. Yeah. But he, being full of the Holy Ghost, looked up steadfastly into heaven and saw the glory of God and Jesus standing on the right hand of God. Verse 56, and said, so Stephen is now saying, behold, I see the heavens opened and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. So what's significant about that? So Jesus had been seated, and now he sees him standing. So if you ask any seminary grad, why was Jesus standing? And what I was taught, Jesus was going to standing up to shake the hand of Stephen, the first martyr to come to heaven. Is that right? That's what I was taught. No, that's fantasy. It is absolute fantasy to think that Jesus would stand to shake the hand of a martyr. There isn't a single scripture that says Jesus stands to shake the hands of those that die for him. So, why is Jesus standing? Psalm 110, verse 1. And this is why Jesus had quoted them this. Peter reminded the Jews of this in his sermon. Turn to Psalm 110, verse 1. Why is Jesus standing? And now we will find out why the response of the council was as it we will see now to be. Psalm 110, verse 1. The Lord said unto my Lord, there's God speaking to God, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. The Lord shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion, rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. So, Jesus is standing because Israel has sinned a sin, the council has sinned a sin that cannot be forgiven. What is that sin that cannot be forgiven? Blasphemy of the Holy Ghost. Turn to Matthew chapter 12. Matthew chapter 12. There's one sin that Israel could not, Paul the Apostle could not be forgiven for this sin. But he found mercy. Matthew chapter 12, verse 31. Matthew 12, verse 31. Wherefore I say unto you, all manner of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men. All right? All manner of sin, all manner of blasphemy. That means you could blaspheme the face of Jesus. Go up to Jesus and blaspheme his face, and you could be forgiven. The Jew could be forgiven. Watch. But the blasphemy against the Holy Ghost shall not be forgiven. Whosoever speaketh a word against the Son of Man, it shall be forgiven him. But whosoever speaketh against the Holy Ghost, it shall not be forgiven him, neither in this world, neither in the world to come. All right? There is no forgiveness for the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. What was Stephen full of? The Holy Ghost. What were they doing? They were being blasphemous towards this man who was full of the Holy Ghost. And so, Stephen says, and he said, verse 56, back to Acts chapter 7, after he says, I see Jesus standing on the right hand of God. These are Jews that Stephen is speaking to. What verse would have come to their mind? Psalm 110, verse 1. Of course, they didn't have chapters and verses in those days, but they would have known this writing. They would have known the writing, and they would have remembered that it was said of Jesus that he was going to return in judgment. And so now They go crazy.
And also, by saying those words, what he was really saying to them is that you are the enemies.
Yes.
He's standing against.
Yes. He's really laying it down. So now
that made him crazy.
Right. They made him crazy. Verse 56, and said, behold, I see the heavens opened, and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God. Is Stephen being stoned here?
No.
No, he's not being stoned. He's very much alive, and he's still very much saying exactly what the Holy Ghost wishes him to say. Verse 57, then they, that would be the council, cried out with a loud voice and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord. So now they've gone crazy. They've gone absolutely crazy.
Because they think he's saying that the Son of God is now coming to judge you?
Right. In fact, he's now saying, he's actually telling them, prophecy is now being fulfilled. It's going to be fulfilled. Jesus is standing, which means he's going to come back. He's going to judge you. That's what he's saying. So they cried out, verse 57, they cried out with a loud voice. They stopped their ears, you know, they put their hands over their ears. They went crazy. They ran upon him with one accord. And note verse 58, and cast him out of the city. So they drag him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet whose name was Saul. So Saul was there. He was with the council. He saw all that was going on. He participated in all that was going on. And Paul himself participated in charging Stephen with blasphemy.
It could be safe to say that Paul would chuck stones at him.
So Paul would have thrown stones, but what they did rather was they laid their clothes at his feet. So he was evidently at a position where he wasn't throwing the stones, but he was holding the coats of those who were throwing the stones. So Paul was just as guilty of stoning Stephen as those that were actually throwing the stones.
So basically, once this happened, Stephen said, God's coming to judge you.
Yes.
If there was no grace period, there was no dispensation of grace, this would have gone right into the seventh to the 70th week of Daniel.
It would have gone into the 70th week of Daniel, but it didn't have to do with grace.
Yes.
Didn't have to do with grace because grace had not yet appeared.
Right.
Yeah.
Only found grace had appeared to individuals. But at this point, they are still under the law.
Right.
And under the law, there is no forgiveness for blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. So now they are stoning Stephen. And now Jesus is standing. They're stoning Stephen. And verse 59, and they stoned Stephen, calling upon God and saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. So Stephen says two things. This is his first statement. He knows he's going to die now because he's being stoned. And the Jews were very good and making sure that when somebody was stoned, that they were dead. Verse 60, and he kneeled down, Stephen kneeled down, and cried with a loud voice, note these words, Lord, lay not this sin to their charge. And when he had said this, he fell asleep. Now, these words, Lord, the prayer of Stephen, Stephen is full of the Holy Ghost. His words are being driven by the Holy Ghost. Stephen's prayer is, lay not this sin to their charge. What does that mean? Does it mean forgive them?
No.
No. It means give them a pass. It means let this just be a warning. Don't charge them. It's like when I get pulled over for a traffic violation, and the policeman says, I'll give you a warning. All right, so he says, I've given you a warning. He makes note of the warning. He makes note of the warning, and then he says, I'm not gonna write you up a ticket. The ticket then would lead to punishment, right? There's no punishment coming now because he says, lay not this sin to their charge. This is actually now, this is an intercessory prayer asking for a period of not forgiveness, but of mercy. And this is actually a stayed judgment. So Jesus would now not come in judgment. Has this happened before? Yes, this has happened before. Turn with me to Numbers. Yeah, Numbers 16.
You know, using those words, lay not this sin to their charge, it's like their charge refers to a list of charges, right?
Yeah.
That they're going to be judged for.
Yes.
And he's saying, just don't add this to that. That'll come. That'll come. That judgment will come, but don't add this to that.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I do know what you're saying, but the reason that Jesus stood was because they had committed a sin that could not be forgiven. So it was the sin that could not be forgiven that would cause Jesus to stand, because there's no forgiveness. So now judgment follows. And judgment would follow unless there was an intercession of mercy. Not forgiveness, because it can't be forgiven.
Yeah, no, I get that.
So now, so they've committed a sin that cannot be forgiven. We know, they know that they can't be forgiven, the sin of blasphemy against the Holy Ghost. And so now Stephen prays the only prayer that could be invoked to prevent judgment from happening at this time. And that is a prayer that says, give them a break. Stay the charge. If you look at Numbers chapter 16, verse 48. Actually, I'll back up a little bit. Just to verse 47, Numbers 16, verse 47. And Aaron took as Moses commanded and ran into the midst of the congregation. Behold, the plague was begun among the people, and he put on incense and made an atonement for the people. So a plague now is coming to the people because of what Israel had done. And now Moses and Aaron are doing something to intercede the plague. Verse 48, and he stood between the dead and the living, note, and the plague was stayed. So the judgment that would have continued was stayed because of an intercession.
Is that called
like
a stay of execution?
A stay of execution. Mm-hmm. It's exactly what it is, a stay of execution. They are guilty, and the judgment will happen, but there's been a stay. And a stay is when something is literally, we're not going to go further with it, we're going to stay right here. We'll shelve it. We're just going to shelve it. Now, there's no judgment. You're not pronounced innocent. It is what it is. It's just stayed. Yes, Brother Esmond.
Israel has had so many chances.
Then. Yes.
And
so many chances for Israel. Yeah.
So many acts of mercy from God.
Yeah. Yeah. And this is mercy.
Yeah.
This is not grace. This is mercy. And Paul tells us in 1 Timothy 1:13, he says, he was a blasphemer. He was a blasphemer, and he was injurious, but he found mercy.
So if they would be forgiven, then they wouldn't have Jacob's trouble, the time of Jacob's trouble. Is that right?
If they had been forgiven, but he wasn't being forgiven. He was so the judgment was stayed, which means that the time of Jacob's trouble didn't start. It would have started right here at the stoning of Stephen.
But have they been forgiven now?
No.
So that's what I mean. So they just received mercy.
They received
but
mercy.
Because there's still no forgiveness, the time of Jacob's trouble still has to happen.
Yes. Okay. Yeah. Now, so I get pulled over by the policeman. I'm given a warning. Israel is pulled over and they're given a warning. Now, the next time I get pulled over by the policeman for that infraction, he's going to say, you've already had your warning.
It's written in the book.
It's written in the book. You've already had your warning. And you flaunted the warning that we gave you. The law gave you a warning. You flaunted it. You did the same thing again. So now I'm going to write you a ticket, and you're going to have to pay the penalty. Do you follow? Yeah.
So there's going to be another.
There's going to be another blasphemy, and you can see it in Revelation 13. The blasphemy is going to happen again, and 3.5 years into the time of the tribulation, the 3.5 year point when wrath, the time of wrath begins on earth for Israel, there's going to be a blasphemy again, and that blasphemy is going to now bring the judgment of God down to the earth. So they had their warning. They had their, okay? And so now what happens? Now we enter into a period of time, we're sort of hovering until Paul comes along.
But we have forgiveness.
We have grace. Yes. Yes, because we now have, we've entered into the dispensation of grace.
But remember that this incident of Stephen is happening at the end of that 1 year extension of mercy.
Yeah, yes. So the point being, I've gone long, the point being though that it didn't happen at the cross, it happened a year later where the rejection had, the stumble now turned into the fall. And it was a long fall. They went over a number of years, and Israel continued to diminish. And this is when now Jew and Gentile come together in the body of Christ under the ministry of the Apostle Paul. So I'm gonna end now, because, and we'll pick up. I'll do a little bit of a recapitulation next week, and we'll see now the transition. But what you've seen is that the rejection of Jesus at the cross was forgiven, but the rejection of God through the Holy Ghost here 1 year later was not forgiven, but it was stayed. The judgment was stayed. Okay, and then that allowed now for that period, the 7 year period, to be put into the future, and that Paul's ministry and the body of Christ could start, and we now had our opportunity to come to grace through Jesus Christ, through his word. All right, so we've gone long. My apology for that, but we'll pick up. We'll do a little bit of an overlap as we continue forward. Let's pray. Our Father God, we're grateful, Lord, for these things that we've seen today and what we've learned and understood from these things in Scripture, how that all sin was forgiven of man, sin against the Son of Man, sin against the Father. All these sins were forgiven, even at the time of the cross when you said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. But we've come to see now, Lord, how that those words that were said as to not being able to receive forgiveness for blasphemy against the Holy Ghost had come to its point, and that yet mercy was provided Israel, and judgment was stayed to come yet at a future time. We're grateful, Lord, that even at that time, that because that judgment didn't come, we've entered into now the dispensation of God's grace, a time when sins are not being imputed to man, and salvation comes to us in believing and trusting in what Christ has done, his finished work, that we can stand in it, that we are completed in him, that we are made a new creature, we are sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, a purchased possession to the day of redemption, when Christ himself will come for his purchased possession, the body of Christ, and call it to himself. We thank you for this. We pray your thanks to you for Christ's sake. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. All right. Brother Phil.